retired brothers and sisters.
I should want to say how delighted we are to return once again to Johnson City and to your preaching mission. It seems every time I come here, it snows. The last time I was here, I tried to get home on a train and it snowed. And I certainly hope that I'll be able to get home tomorrow. Two real reasons that I wanted to come, particularly, I suppose, first because I wanted to preach. Secondly, is because, and perhaps not as important, but important to me, my little boy, who's 4 years old, instructed me that before I left, he said, "Daddy, you bring me home a coonskin cap." And these 3 days, I've been looking all over for a coonskin cap. He thinks everybody in Tennessee wear a coonskin cap. I haven't been able to find one, but I've decided how I'm going to rectify the situation. I'm going to buy him a Tennessee coonskin cap as soon as I get in Washington, D.C. In the 9th chapter of Mark, the 23rd verse, we find the words, "If thou canst believe, all things are possible to him that believeth." And we should want to talk to you about the power of believing. For the greatest force that is in the earth is the power of believing. The fact of the matter is that the earth itself and everything that is in it or about it is no more nor less than tangible and intangible manifestations born out of the thought of God. And if there is anything in earth that makes man akin to God, it is his power to believe, his power to think, his power to make decisions. For things are to us what they are on the basis of what we believe them to be, whether they be true or whether they be false. If, for example, you believe that a straight line is the shortest distance between two points, then for you this is true in spite of the fact that there is no such thing as a straight line in a crooked world. Or if you believe that a black cat crossing your path will give you bad luck, then for you this is true, in spite of the fact that you can always find in life whatever you are looking for. Or if you believe because, say, you are 65 years of age or more, that you have one foot in the grave and the other on a banana peel, you are already dead. But if you believe that God can take you and use you in spite of your years, you would be amazed to know how you could be used to God's honor and God's glory. The fact of the matter is that many of us get old too fast, far out of the context of our use to the world, to the end that indeed the greatest reservoir of intelligence and strength that we have in this nation today is resided within that broad area of humanity between the years of 62 and 80. And if only we would come to realize this, how important and significant it would be in our lives. That age is not something that can be geared in terms of chronological years, but is something that can be geared in terms of spiritual and psychological force. We are to a large measure as old as we think we are. I remember a few years ago, about 2 years ago,
One of my members, he's about 80 years of age, he was walking on the other side of the street. There was a young woman with him, and he hailed me, and he said, "Brother Pastor, would you kindly come over a moment? I want to ask you a question." I walked across the street, and he looked at me, and he said, "Brother Pastor, I want to know if it's all right for me to get married." I looked at him, and I looked at the young woman. She was about 40 years of age, and I looked at him. He was 80, and his knees were shaking. And I took out my book real quick, and I said, "Brother, let's get this thing over with, because time is fleeing." I've always said that there was a man who truly believed. But to a large measure, this is true. That more and more we have to come to realize the power of believing. And that indeed we are as old as we think we are. To a large measure, too, we are ill in comparison to the motives of our thinking. To the end that many of the illnesses that disturb us physiologically have been traceable to the context and the direction of the mind. I remember before I got married, I met my wife in New York, and when I was courting her, I took her to the theater one night, and right in the middle of the play, in the second act, she elbowed me, and she said, "Dear," she said, "let's get out of here." She said, "My head, it's bursting. I have a terrible headache." Well, as I said, the hero and the girl were getting together, and I wanted to see what was going to happen, so I acted as though I didn't hear her. A few seconds later, she elbowed me again. She said, "Dear," she said, "my head is bursting." She said, "Let's go, let's go." So I took her hand because I wanted to see the play through, and I put something in it. I said, "Now, darling, you put this under your tongue, and in a little while, you'll feel much better. It's wonderful for headaches." She put it under her tongue. A few seconds, she elbowed me again. She said, "Dear, I feel fine." When the play was over and we were walking under the marquee, she looked up at me with her big brown eyes and she said, "Darling," she said, "what kind of pill was that you gave me for headaches?" I said, "It was the best I've ever taken." I said, "Take it from under your tongue and look at it." And she did, and it was a button off my shirt. To the end that many of our medical scholars, those who are involved in the process of medical care, are more and more coming to the realization that many of the ills that plague us and disturb us are actually illnesses of the mind. That women, for example, who when they see every pimple and every bump are concerned as to whether perhaps it's cancerous. Medical science is more and more coming to realize that perhaps 60% or the source of cancer is something that can be traceable to the analyzation of the processes of the human mind. That often we think things exist that are not really there and bring them into being out of the direction of our thoughts. The power of believing, if we will come to believe. And after all, this is what Jesus did, is it not? This is not what he did throughout his ministry. He taught men to believe in their possibilities and to believe in themselves. He saw the little boy and he said to the little boy in epilepsy, he said to the parents, "Do you believe? For if you believe, the boy can be made whole." He saw a man who had been lame since his childhood, and he said to the man, "If you can believe, you can take up your bed and walk." And throughout his ministry, he was teaching men and women and boys and girls to believe in themselves and to believe in the power of God. And essentially, this is what we want to believe. But there are some fundamental things that we must come to believe if true life is to be full for us, and if indeed we can come to live in a world where there is peace and harmony and happiness for humankind. The first thing we must come to believe in this world is that every one of us in it must come to believe that there is something that is eternally sacred about human. And that wherever a man comes from, wherever he is born, whomever he is, that he is something special because God made him and because God breathed into him the breath of life. And that wherever he is, whomever he is, that he is somebody special. And in this world of ours, we shall never beat our swords into plowshares, nor our spears into pruning hooks, until we come to realize this fundamental basic concept of our religion and of Jesus, that every man is somebody in the sight of God. This word came to me very forcibly, some
16 years ago when I was pastoring a little church in New Jersey. It was just a little church with 150 members, and but it was the most wonderful ministry a young man could have. I loved my church. I loved the people. I loved the community. There was only one thing of my ministry there that disturbed me, no small end, and it was the fact that the parsonage had mice in it. Every night, the mice would come. One night, about 1 o'clock in the morning, my wife awakened me and she said, "Dear, I think I hear them downstairs." Well, I got out of bed with her and there was a broomstick at the head of the stairs, and I let my wife go down first and I came after her because I don't like mice either. There in the bin of the icebox were a few little mice, and they were pounding themselves within the bin, trying to free themselves. And I took that broom behind my head, and I was about to crack them with it, when something spoke to me to seem to say, "Sullivan, what do you know what life means to a mouse?" And I ask you tonight, what do you know what life means to a mouse? And if life has value to a mouse and to any creeping thing, how much more so has life value to a human being made in the likeness and image of God? And wherever a man may live, whether it be in China or in Russia or in Norway or in Sweden or in India or in Timbuktu, if God has made him, his life is sacred, and whom are we to decide as to whether it should be taken or not? And until in this world we come to realize that there is something that is eternally sacred about human life, we shall never, I repeat, beat our swords into plowshares and our spears into plumes. Next, we must come to believe that faith in God gives meaning and purpose to life, and that God can take any life, however low it may seem to be, and God can take that life and reshape it and bless it and stand that life upon its feet. That any boy or girl in this world, when they are touched by the love of God, God will make men and women out of them. 12 years ago, I came to Philadelphia to pastor my church that is located, was then in the center of the crime-ridden sector of Philadelphia, the highest crime rate perhaps in the United States. I remember after the first week, I went out to take a walk in my neighborhood that I might meet my neighbors. And there on the street corner, I found 5 boys, and they were playing cards on the street corner, and there was profanity all around them. And when one of them saw me coming, he looked up and he said, "Oh, don't worry about him. He's just the new preacher." I went back to the church, got an old basketball that I had brought from my home in West Virginia with me. And I went out and found the biggest boy in the lot. And I asked him to catch the ball because I knew a little bit about basketball. The fact is, I was about the best basketball player I've ever seen. And I threw the ball to the boy, and the boy dropped it. And then the 6 of us went to a gymnasium that had been converted out of an old church building. There all day long, the 6 of us played basketball together. These 5 boys, all of whom had dropped out of school. These 5 boys, each one of whom had had encounters with the law. These 5 boys who were considered zero boys in the neighborhood and boys without hope. Boys who would end up in the penitentiary or into some institution. This was the record they had. The next Sunday morning, these 5 boys came to Sunday school. A week later, these boys came into membership for the Sunday school. I baptized these 5 boys. The members of my church put their arms around the boys and tried to encourage them and help them and to inspire them. 2 years ago, we attempted to evaluate what had happened to the boys and girls who had come through our community center program. And this is what had happened to those five boys. One boy is now a government officer in Washington, D.C. A second boy is now the supervisor of a division in the Philadelphia Gas Works. Third boy was a captain in the United States Marine Corps just 2 weeks ago and will become a major within the next month. Fourth boy was the first Phi Beta Kappa to graduate from Howard University, finished at the head of the medical school 3 years later, and now is my personal physician. And the fifth boy now makes more money in 3 months playing basketball than I make in 3 years preaching. Five boys of whom it was said there was no hope. Five boys of whom it was said zero impossibilities, no hope for them. But the love of God was brought into their hearts, and love surrounded their lives. And some people gave the boys a helping hand and helped them to believe that somebody did love them. And now five of the finest men to be found anywhere in the United States of America. You tell me what God can do. I say to you that faith in God gives meaning and purpose to life. And wherever you find a boy or girl in Johnson City, however down he may seem to be, if you will lift him and pray for him and get the love of Christ in his heart, God will stand him up and put him on his feet. The preaching of the Word of God is the only hope for the world. And that is, the Bible says, through the foolishness of preaching, the world will be saved. Not by your missiles, nor by our submarines, nor by our marching armies, but by the marching of the Word of God, conquering and to conquer. I have seen what the power of the Word of God can do. Last year, the West German government invited me to the Republic of Germany to go throughout the Republic to make an evaluation of the progress of the democratization of the West German Republic. And I traveled through all the Länder of Germany. And I spoke in their schools and met the men in their councils and their ministers of interior and of justice and of state. But remember, I ended my trip in West Berlin, and I just addressed a group in the capital of West Berlin on behalf of the West German government as an American citizen brought there. That night, about midnight in my hotel, I received a telephone call from a young woman who was present at the ceremony that afternoon in the West Berlin City Hall. She said that a group of young people wanted to hear me preach, not to speak, but to preach, and ask if I would come, although she could not tell me where I would be taken. And I said, of course, that although I was there on the business of the government, but more than that, I was always on business for God. 1 o'clock in the morning, a Volkswagen drove up to the Hilton Hotel in West Berlin. There, two young people took me around through the dark streets of West Berlin, in that sector where there were no lights. But I was there just 2 weeks before the brick wall went up, of which you have heard so much. And there in the outskirts of the rural acres of West Berlin, I found where the barbed wire that you have come to know as the Iron Curtain, it consisted actually little more than of a barbed wire that stretched across the country, where the barbed wire had been snipped and snapped. And through the dales and through the farms, this Volkswagen went until we came to a farmhouse that could be illuminated and seen only by the brilliance of the moon. There I found hundreds of young people and old trucks and bicycles and all kinds of contraptions in which young people had come all from communist Germany to hear the word of God. That night, I found out for the first time in my life what Pentecost really was. For whenever you find men and women, boys and girls, who are hungry for the Word of God and whose hearts are open and receptive to the word, the Holy Spirit has to come and fill every heart. You are not hungry for the gospel in America, but where there are young men and women who do not hear the gospel of Jesus Christ, where it is something, if they worship God, to be penalized in their schools and in their employment and in their families, it is something again. These young people were there from all over that sector of communist Germany, and we preached. When we were finished, a number of the young people asked if they might come back to West Berlin with us, as dangerous even then as it was, and they filled the back of the Volkswagen. On our way back, I heard a boy, and he was unable to hold the stiflings of his cries, for he was crying there, and I asked him, "Why are you crying, young man?" And he said, "Because tonight, Pastor, tonight I became a Christian, and I'm so happy." And I said, "Good morning. Good morning. See what God can do." The next Sunday morning, I preached at the First Baptist Church of West Berlin. The rain was pummeling down. 9:30 in the morning, the pastor himself did not realize where all the people came from. They filled the balconies, flowed out into the churchyard by the hundreds, only to find that these young men and women who heard the preaching of the word of God, some of them for the first time, had brought their friends and their relatives and their neighbors into West Berlin to the church, that they too might hear the word of Jesus Christ preached. The only hope of the world is not in all of our education. For without Jesus in our hearts, we are only educated fools. It is not just in our armies, on our missiles, on our bombs, but that the hope of the world is in the preaching of the word of God. When a man is not afraid to preach the word, and who will preach it as God gives him it to preach, it will touch the hearts of men, and the hearts of men will be moved. Not only must we preach it, but we must practice it. For a religion that is preached and is not practiced is a religion that is dead. A heaven into which we can go when we die is of no value unless you get some heaven in yourself while you live. And it is no good to keep you out of hell unless you get some hell out of you. It is a matter of living this thing that you preach about. And it is an indictment to our religion. It is an indictment to our religion that we have forfeited our role in the humanities by the way that we have oppressed and degraded our brothers. Or how can a man say he loved God whom he has not seen, and still hate his brother whom he sees every day? It is not a question as to whether you can receive a man because he is not the color that you are, but it is the question as to whether you can reject a man because you are Christian. Whenever a man has the love of Jesus Christ in his heart, that man becomes colorblind. Tragedy of our religion is in the fact that if Jesus Christ, an Asiatic Jew, whose appearances is similar to the Asiatic Jews that I have seen in the Holy Land today, if he were to come to our Western world, there would be many hotels in which he could not sleep and many public schools in which he could not enroll. It is a tragedy and a travesty to our religion that this is true. It is a concern of ours, not just because we are Christians, though, but too because of the future of generations to come, that we must, if we love the Lord, we've got to practice what we preach. God is moving in America now in a wonderful way. 4 years ago, I was here, and I have seen how God is moving in Johnson City, but he still has a lot more moving to do. We've got to learn that a Jesus and a religion that lives is a Jesus and a religion that loves. Then we've got to learn to practice it with our neighbors. For life is a journey, and on the road of life, there will be those who will mean you well, And there will be those who will throw rocks at you when your back is turned. But when they throw rocks at you, do not pick them up and throw them back at them. Rather, pick up the rocks and take them with you. And when you have gathered enough of them, make yourself a rock garden and plant it with forget-me-nots. And when you get to the top of the hill, make a light so that those who threw rocks at you can find the way. But to the extent that you help and love your neighbor and your fellow man, to that extent will God bless your soul. If we will believe, there is nothing God will not do with or for us. And come what may to us in this life, we will need not fear in life nor in death. For come what may, then, believing, we shall be like the bird who, halting in flight, on limb so slight, feels the limb bend beneath him, and yet he can sing because he knows God gave him wings. The Lord bless you.